been a lot of issues discussed at this conference the last few days. Out of these, could you select three or four of issues that you think are the big issues for Africa or new directions for the continent?
Industrialization is really the most important entry point for the discussion about structural transformation. So I think what this conference really added to the debate was the experiences from other parts of the world and the historical perspective that is in our transformative policies report, and also the greening dimension, the environmental dimension into the industrialization of the continent. Now, the second pick for me would be our report on corruption, because it is an attempt for us to adjust the debate to the needs of Africa. We are very critical of the indexes that have been produced based on perception, and we think that it is high time for everybody to give a bit more credit to the efforts that Africa is making in this field. And my third pick would be what we have done in terms of regional integration, because it is quite a remarkable achievement to have three institutions that are in charge of African issues, ADB, the African Union, and ourselves, the Economic Commission for Africa, pulling together to produce a regional integration index. Now, this index is just the first installment of something more ambitious. What we have done right now was to check the implementation by each country of what they have signed for. But we want to go a bit further and make sure that we are also going to capture the rankings for the entire continent. And this is going to be based on what are the critical elements for regional integration that go beyond, obviously, trade. Although trade continues to be important, we want it to be more comprehensive.
You've talked a lot about regional integration, and there's been a lot of talk about it at this conference. At a previous conference, I heard you say that regional integration is actually moving too slowly. Do you think that the regional integration index that's just been launched is going to fast track this in any way and move it forward more quickly?
Definitely, we are counting on that. We are counting on the debate becoming less and less political and more technical. Because the moment the debate is more technical, we know it is grounded, and we know people will not get away with just easy proclamations of intentions. And this index is a very good demonstration of where countries need to focus in order for things really to move. And I think it's going to be the subject of a lot of debates, community by community. All the regional economic communities are being assessed, and it will demonstrate that some are not doing very well and they need to do much faster progress.
There's been a lot of emphasis on industrialization and particularly green industrialization at this conference, and yet there are many people who say that actually the continent is de-industrializing. What are the triggers for industrialization in your view that haven't happened but now you believe will happen in order to trigger the green industrial path for Africa?
Well, actually, Africa's contribution to manufacturing and industrialization has to be measured, like in any part of the world, through manufacturing value addition. And that one is going actually down, it's true. In the last few years, it has gone down by 1%. One may say it's marginal, but I would say it's significant because we are in a period of growth and would have expected manufacturing value addition to pick up, not to stagnate, even less to regress. But this being said, it's also misleading to say that it is de-industrializing. Why? Because, you know, the size of Africa's GDP has more than doubled over the last 15 years. It's close to tripling, which basically means that it's a much bigger economy. So if we have, in percentage terms, less, doesn't mean there is less industry. Now, what I think it's important for us to bear in mind is that the type of industry that we require for structural transformation is still not really taking root. It's basically three. It's agro-processing because of its pulling factor on agricultural productivity. It's also commodity-based industrialization because it will allow for our natural resources to have more beneficiation. And we should not dream of having total control of the chains, of the value chains. it will suffice for us to add another 15% of value addition to the average 10 that we already have, and it will create about 7 million jobs a year. And finally, the third entry point for industrialization is really, you know, benefiting from rising labor costs in Asia, particularly in China, and the need for them to delocalize certain manufacturing industries, which, you know, actually end up there because they were delocalized from Europe and other industrialized countries. So it's their time also to dish them out because they have upgraded their skills, their innovation, their technology, and they control now chains of value that are, you know, very important. So I think Africa can benefit from that, but by all means, it's not automatic. We have competition.
There seems to be a lot of sentiment, anti-sentiment about the private sector at this conference. A lot of reports are being released that criticize what the private sector is doing and the way they're doing it. Do you feel that they're getting a bad rap at this conference? Do you think that they're not playing the ball with the agencies, with the politics of development, and could be doing things differently?
You know, good policies, good strategic policies are policies that, you know, address market failures, and there are market failures. But I would resist the temptation of, diabolizing the private sector. You know, they will make the best out of the context. If the context is tight, you still have the private sector operating, and sometimes even more successfully than in countries where there is complete mess and where, you know, everything is allowed. I say this because, you know, we all follow the ease of doing business of the World Bank, and countries want to be ranked as one of the best reformers in that index every year. And at the end of the day, insofar as Africa is concerned, some of the countries attracting most investment are not doing very well in that index because there are other incentives that are also important for the private sector. It is important, for instance, to mention that the index may value, you know, very flexible labor laws. And yet, you know, countries that have very large labor availability may be attractive nevertheless, like Ethiopia. So I think it's a mix, and you have in the private sector all types of behavior. You have, you know, predator behavior, as well as you have, you know, more social responsible behavior. And we have to just, you know, make sure that the regulatory system and the incentive system is contributing to progress that is done in a win-win atmosphere. And this is absolutely possible.
A lot of the issues you hear at these kind of conferences are about resource mobilization. And yet a lot of the things that could be done with very little money, possibly just a lot more political will, are not happening. I mean, is there too much emphasis on the resourcing and not enough on the political will?
Well, I think the reason there is so much emphasis on financing is because Africa has realized that to industrialize, it needs to do significant investment on infrastructure. It starts with infrastructure because of the role infrastructure plays, and energy in particular, without which you cannot really industrialize. And I think infrastructure, because of its nature, requires a completely different type of financing. It's long-term type of deals. It needs a de-risking strategy on the part of the public sector to attract the private money. You need financial engineering that is much more complex. And you have upfront costs with feasibility studies that are quite high. So because of these characteristics, people are looking for big bucks. And because they are looking for big bucks, they are discussing a lot financing nowadays. And I think resource mobilization is just a cop-out. I think it's much more interesting to be talking about domestic resource mobilization. Without the domestic, it becomes again an attempt to try to lure some development aid money, some concessional funding, which obviously may come, but it will never be sufficient. We are not going to develop without having a good fiscal and tax system, without governments being capable of actually taxing in relation to the real size of the economies. And for that, you know, you have to go you know, the more difficult road. It's not an easy task, but it's the one that really pays off at the end.
You've spoken before about a new proud Africa. What are the elements of pride that you that inform that statement?
Well, I think the, one of the reasons is, of course, the sense of confidence that was given by growth, although it was growth without quality. And now we are seeing it. The moment external shocks get back, you know, that growth is shaken. It's still the best performer continent in the world, but it's not performing at the same level as, say, India, which is a very good comparator for us because of the size of its population. If India can grow at 7% and has a per capita right now that is lower than Africa, you know, it shows the way, it is possible. But I think the real reason also for the pride comes from the fact that we have a new crop of leaders. And I like really to define the leadership change that is taking place in the continent as one that goes beyond the strongman approach, you know, the president, the head of state. The leadership that we are seeing emerging is a leadership that is much more collective, vast, and with a number of actors that is not just limited to, say, the public figures of the past. And I think that is very important because that's where you get, you know, some entrepreneurs that are investing a lot in Africa. The segment of investment that is growing the most in Africa is the intra-Africa investment. The fact that you have now people that are thinking about science and technology, the fact that you have also countries that are demonstrating the way with innovative ways of dealing with public policy. So I think we are really proud because of all these developments at the same time, not because we can point fingers to a few presidents.
Thank you very much for sharing your time and your insights with IC Publications.